Good morning. Welcome to the United Methodist Church of the Dunes online worship service for this week. We're grateful for you being with us. We hope you find our service a blessing. And now let's learn a little bit more about the ministry of our church and some announcements that we have for you. Next week is our communion celebration. If you'll be communing with us online, we invite you to get some bread and juice and have them prepared prior to watching our video next week. If you're coming to the sanctuary to our in-person worship service, communion elements will be supplied for you, and they are in sealed containers so that we respect hygiene rules during this pandemic time. We hope you'll join us for one or both of those services. Are you interested in engaging in our adult classes and discussion groups? They're being planned for fall. We hope you'll check out our website and our newsletter to find more information about the classes that will be provided. On Sunday, September 12th, Church of the Dunes will host a re-engage event at the church. The in-person worship service will be followed by refreshments and an opportunity to join our ministry fair, where you'll have opportunities to share your dreams, sign up for a particular activity, or to help in service through our community of faith. Thank you for worshiping with us, and now let us begin our worship service. Won't you join me in our call to worship? Look to the mountains, look to the hills. Love comes to us with joy. The world is filled with beauty. Flowers appear on the earth. Birdsong brightens the day. Crops yield their portion in abundance. The air is filled with sweetness. The summer of God's love is with us. Let the oil of gladness anoint your souls. Arise and sing for joy. Will you sing with me now, For the Beauty of the Earth, verses 1, 2, 4, and 6. Boys and girls, it's time for our children's time. Are there people who you know in your life that have done kind things for you? You remember those, don't you? When somebody offers you a kindness, there's something about somebody acting to help that really makes a difference and makes it memorable. I've also had people in my life that have said, hey, I'd like to help you sometime, or I'd like to get together sometime, but sometime never comes. Our words from James today remind us that words without action don't have the power of God's love in them. that we need to have both word and action. So I hope as you begin this week, use kind words, of course, but also make sure that you're acting kindly and doing things for people that make a difference. Will you pray with me, please? Dear God, bless these children. Help them to act and to love and to say words that are kind, but to do both, not just one. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Have a great week, boys and girls. Please join me in our prayer of confession. God of justice and righteousness, your call beckons to us to live faithful lives, to turn from wickedness, to walk in your ways. Yet it's easy to turn aside, to speak a thoughtless word, to ignore those in need, to strike out in anger, to forget your ways. Forgive us. Implant your word in our hearts and cleanse us from all evil. By the power of your love, save our souls that we might faithfully serve you. Amen. Hear these words of grace. God's word has the power to save us. God has anointed us all with gladness. We are forgiven to live in joy. And now we come to the time of offering. You know that when you're online, you're a long distance from us, but those gifts can come through the internet by going to our website or simply write a check and put it in an envelope and send it to us at 717 Sheldon in Grand Haven, Michigan, 49417. Thank you in advance for your generous gifts and all the support you have given us during this time of pandemic. Thank you. Join me in our prayer of dedication. Generous giving God, we offer our gifts to you in gratitude for all the blessings you rain down on us. Your sunshine warms us, your earth feeds us, and your word nourishes us. More than these gifts of money, we give ourselves, our time, and our energy that we might be doers of your word and not just hearers only. We pray this in the name of Christ, our Savior. Amen. And now a word from our Psalms.
Our first reading this morning comes from the Psalms, chapter 72, verses 1 through 15a. True God, bestow your honest judgments upon the king, and anoint the king's son with your righteousness. May he be honest and fair in his judgments over your people, and offer justice to the burdened and suffering. Under his reign, may this land of mountains and hills know peace and experience justice for all the people. May the king offer justice to the burdened and suffering, rescue the poor and needy, and demolish the oppressor. May the people fear you, for as long as the sun shines, as long as the moon rises in the night sky, throughout the generations. May the king be like the refreshing rains, which fall upon fields of freshly mown grass, like showers that cool and nourish the earth. May good and honest people flourish for as long as he reigns, and may peace fill the land until the moon no longer rises. May the king rule from one sea to the next, and may his rule extend from the Euphrates River to the far reaches of the earth. Let the desert wanderers bow down before him, and his enemies lay prostrate and taste the dirt. Let the kings of Tarshish and the island kings shower him with gifts, and the kings of Sheba and Seba bring him presents as well. Let every king on earth bow down before him, and every nation be in his service. For he will rescue the needy when they ask for help. He will save the burdened and come to the aid of those who have no other help. He offers compassion to the weak and the poor. He will help and protect the lives of the needy. He will liberate them from the fierce sting of persecution and violence. In his eyes, their blood is precious. May he live a long, long time. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Give me eyes to see more of who you are. May what I behold still my anxious heart. Take what I have known and break it all apart. You, my God, are greater still, and the sky contains no doubt restrains all you are. The greatness of our God. Spend my this I am convinced that you, my God, are greater still, and no sky contains.
Hear these words from James chapter 1, verses 17 through 27. And this translation is The Voice. Maybe you'll enjoy that. Every good gift bestowed, every perfect gift received comes to us from above, courtesy of the Father of lights. He's consistent. He won't change his mind or play tricks in the shadows. We have a special role in his plan. He calls us to life by his message of truth so that we will show the rest of his creatures his goodness and love. Listen, open your ears, harness your desire to speak, and don't get worked up into a rage so easily, my brothers and sisters. Human anger is a futile exercise that will never produce God's kind of justice in this world. So walk out on your corrupt liaison with smut and depraved living, and humbly welcome the word of truth that will blossom like the seed of salvation planted in your souls. Put the word into action. If you think hearing is what matters most, you are going to find you have been deceived. If some fail to do what God requires, it's as if they forget the word as soon as they hear it. 1 minute they look in the mirror, and the next they forget who they are and what they look like. However, it is possible to open your eyes and take in the beautiful, perfect truth found in God's law of liberty and live by it. If you pursue the path that actually do what God has commanded, then you will avoid the many distractions that lead to an amnesia of all things true, and you will be blessed. If you put yourself on a pedestal thinking you have become a role model in all things religious, but you can't control your mouth, then think again. Your mouth exposes your heart, and your religion is useless. Real, true religion from God, the Father's perspective, is about caring for the orphans and widows who suffer needlessly and resisting the evil influence of the world. May God bless this reading from Holy Scriptures. Amen. Won't you pray with me? Lord God, pour down your Holy Spirit on us now. Help us discover what it is that you want us to do with the love that you've posited in our lives. Thank you for this church. Thank you for God's people. Help us to do our very best to do your will. In Jesus' name, amen. Pure Michigan. We've all seen the ads. But what does it mean to be pure? Well, the truth is that on those ads, it's very clear. The ads will typically start with a video or pictures of landscapes and sunsets, lighthouses and waterfalls, woods and dunes, and the beauty of Michigan. And then the announcer says, "Pure Michigan." I couldn't help but, as I read the book of James today, to imagine a similar type advertisement that could be made about this passage. The camera rolls. Videos of families sleeping in churches. Kitchens overflowing with soup and meals for the homeless. Food trucks rolling into nearby parking lots as servants pass out food to everyone who needs it. Immigrants being welcomed at Gerald R. Ford Airport in Grand Rapids. English as second language classes being held in church basements, people teaching others how to read at the local library or in a school library. Folks being released from jail, but not to find that they are alone, instead greeted by a smiling face and an open door. A retired gentleman pulling up to a medical center to pick up someone that he is transporting from their home or their apartment or their care center to the hospital and returning. Knitting being taught by volunteers in our local elementary school, prayer shawls being delivered to medically fragile children and adults, a care group formed for widows and orphans. Then the words intoned and scrolled on the screen. Pure religion. That's what we're looking for in the book of James today. When we strip away the confining nature of religious institutions, we find ourselves ready to live free and generous, lives that flow with a deep sense of knowing of how the love of God is expressed in Jesus Christ. How that works. The motivating spirit of generosity within us is offered to us by God as a seed gift. We are invited then to plant that seed and bear fruit in others' lives. We literally are given the opportunity to birth life in others as we authentically listen to God and to others and respond to the community and humanity in our circle and just outside that we might meet. Pure religion. James 1:22 admonishes, put the words into action. That's pure religion. That's what makes religion real, life-giving, and pure. In seminary, we were often asked this question, do you have a high Christology or a low Christology? And I have to admit, the first year I was there, I had to ask first, what is Christology? It's the study or understanding of how Jesus fits into the person of Christ. It was always posed as an either-or question. Either you had a high Christology or a low Christology. A person with a high Christology puts primary attention on the divinity and the awesome power of Jesus. Imagine a picture of Jesus on the throne or the judgment seat, reigning from heaven, powerful, triumphant, victorious, seated, we're told, at the right hand of God. Now, low Christology has a grittier, earthbound, Jesus is healer, human, teacher, suffering servant. He humbly bears the burden of suffering as he's crucified, while calling for help from the Father and feeling a sense of abandonment. Dr. Barbara Holmes, an African woman theologian, reflected this week on the notion of a personal Jesus and a universal Christ. She says, as an African American woman, that she grew up with a preference for the flesh and blood divinity of Jesus because of the suffering, rejection, and redemption of my own people. In other words, she had a low Christology. Jesus was framed as kindred spirit to the oppressed and the marginalized of this world. These people tended to be influenced more by Jesus with skin on, not a distant savior, but a real human that understands our plight and experiences it with us. You might insert the song, "What a Friend We Have in Jesus, All Our Sin and Hope to Bear." This way of thinking is comforting. The person that goes hand in hand with us wherever we go. But Barbara goes on to say that she had learned that the particularity of Jesus does not obliterate the universality or the everythingness of Christ. In other words, it's not either or. Our deep knowing, are we realizing that there's an animating spark within us that is the Christ, the Holy Spirit, the resurrection force that Jesus humbly took, that took him from humble servant to transforming power to universal Christ. So the proclamation after the resurrection becomes Jesus Christ is Lord, or Jesus Christ is risen. The same power that brought Jesus to life then is given to us as gift, as seed, to transform even us, to move us from humble servant into powerful force in this world, not so that we can lord it over each other, but so that we might acknowledge that no matter what our circumstances, there is a force more powerful that resides in and among us. Jesus at one point says to his disciples, "I am the light of the world." Now that's a powerful statement. It relates to that higher Christology. But then he turns, looks his disciples in the eye and said, "You are the light of the world." These are the same disciples who doubted, who gave up, who ran away later, who were confused often when Jesus taught them in what seemed to be simple stories and metaphors, they now were told they are the light of the world. Insert here, we, because Jesus is also saying it to us. You are the light of the world. Glennon Doyle, wife of superstar soccer player Abby Wambach, wrote in her recent book, Untamed, how we might discover our calling. She said, we all want purpose and connection. Tell me what breaks your heart, and I will point you to both. And when she says both, she means that purpose and connection are what give us meaning in our life. She and her wife, Abby, have worked tirelessly to raise the place of women in our society and throughout the world as they created a nonprofit. When asked how she finds her purpose, she acknowledges it comes from a place deep in her. She knows. She just knows where to move next. Something comes in front of her and it points her in a new direction. She learned that through her own religious institution-controlled life, that when she didn't follow her passion, when she looked outside for other people to order and tell her who she was, she didn't have passion for what then she did. Now she said, God is not a being outside of me, God. God is the fire, the nudge, the warm liquid, gold swelling and pressing inside of me. That fire to which she refers is the unleashed power of the Holy Spirit, or what we call the resurrected Christ. It's the love of God rising up in her. With that spirit and power within us, we all have the opportunity, the probability and possibility of becoming. As we do that, what a friend we have in Jesus becomes, what a power or strength we find in Christ. A Christ that continues to inhabit hearts and empower lives. And when we know that, when we experience it, when we recognize and acknowledge it, we rise in and with Christ. Glennon would often say to her daughter, life is hard. But then her follow-up statement is this, we do hard things. Why? Because Christ is with us in our suffering and salvation, yes, but also in our rising and in our victories. James 1:25 reminds us that if you pursue the path and actually do what God has commanded, then you will avoid the many distractions that lead to amnesia of all true things, and you will be blessed. Let me say that again. If you pursue the path and actually do what God has commanded, then you will avoid the many distractions that lead to amnesia of all true things, and you will be blessed. Real religion is about loving, forgiving, caring. James reminds us of the words of Jesus, do unto others as you would have them do unto you. And if we do that, then maybe, just maybe, we'll remember what God in Christ has done for us. Let's keep praying. Let's keep listening to God. And let's start acting for God and for others. In Jesus' name, amen. Let us pray. Lord God, a lot of widows and orphans were made this week. Whether we look at the destruction in Afghanistan or the torrential rains, the floodings, the hurricanes and storms, so many people suffering today, or the fires that have destroyed whole cities. Lord, have mercy. We need your grace and we need your love, but people need our help. So empower us. Give us vision for the future. Help us to reach out into the world where the need is the greatest and touch and meet the needs of lives that we might have ignored before. Revisit with us the testimony of your grace in Jesus Christ so that we might live the testimony of grace in our lives. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us now, that we might be your hands and feet in the world. As we pray the prayer that Jesus taught us, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Will you sing with me now? Great is thy faithfulness. By the word of God, go to act on that word in your lives by sharing Jesus's love with others. Amen. Thank you so much for being here. We hope you'll join us again next week for a word from the Church of the Dunes and God's Scriptures.